This court for this session now resumes. Thank you.
I'm Judge Gould, presiding today and sitting with Judge Bennett and Judge Nelson. This case is set for 20 minutes per side. And we'll hear first from the appellant's counsel, Ms. Wang, and then from Ms. Wrights. If the appellant wants to make a rebuttal, try to stop before your 20 minutes. Did you stop? But as a softie during pandemic, if either of you need a little more time and you ask for it, I'll say yes, even though I may be getting the Ninth Circuit scheduling gods mad. Please proceed, Ms. Wang.
Thank you, Your Honor. Elizabeth Wang for Plaintiff Debra Milke. I would like to reserve 6 minutes of rebuttal time. Debra Milke has a meritorious civil case. She spent over 23 years as an innocent woman on death row due to the egregious misconduct of defendants, including fabrication of evidence and serious Brady violations that resulted in this court granting her habeas relief in 2013. Through this lawsuit, Ms. Milke sought redress for her decades of wrongful imprisonment, but instead of imposing available lesser sanctions for alleged discovery violations and giving Ms. Milke a chance to prove the merits of her case to a jury, the district court dismissed it in its entirety.
So let me interrupt you a minute, counsel. So is it your view that what we are looking at here are alleged discovery violations, not actual discovery violations?
They are discovery violations that do not warrant the extraordinary sanction of dismissal. And in some instances, which we point out in our briefs,
what do they warrant? What do they warrant in your opinion?
Well, there's adverse, to the extent that the court found that there was spoliation of evidence, there's an adverse inference instruction that could be given, which the district courts could structure any number of ways.
Yeah, but the district court said, and I may be paraphrasing here, that for some of the thing, the district court said the main focus in the trial is going to be who's telling the truth, Ms. Milke, or is it Officer Saldate? Is that how you pronounce his name? That's the main issue, credibility. And that so many of the destroyed materials could have directly borne on Ms. Milke's credibility, like her journal, which was destroyed. And there's no way that an adverse inference would be sufficient, because it's entirely possible that all of these things or some of them would have shown Ms. Milke not being credible. So how does an adverse inference, why did the district court abuse its discretion in finding that that wasn't sufficient?
Well, first, there's the district court's factual findings with respect to the evidence that it said was destroyed or the evidence that was produced late were clearly erroneous. And this goes to two things. It goes to the lack of prejudice to the defendants, as well as to the clear error by the district court in its findings.
I'm going to regret asking this question, but please tell me which facts were clearly erroneous, because I heard a lot of argument about that. And there's like 15 facts that were adverse, you know, on the discovery violation. And I wasn't clear which ones you were attacking that you would say were clearly erroneous.
Okay, so for instance, with respect to the findings about the documents in her mother's house in Germany, where Debra went to Germany in 2017, that she recycled copies of documents that her mother had, what Debra testified to was that there were copies of public court filings, her habeas filings that her mother had, because her habeas counsel routinely sent copies of those things to her counsel, as well as copies of newspaper articles.
Well, okay, but back up. The district court said, okay, well, go ahead. Tell me what the district court found, and then, yeah.
What the district court found is that because there was no record of what was destroyed, it's just her say-so. But that is plainly not true.
And that I disagree with that. I mean, Number one, we don't even know what all was destroyed from the original documents. And number two, is there any contemporaneous evidence that nothing else other than copies existed with her mother in Germany?
What we cited to in our opening brief and in the reply were her mother's letters to her counsel dated in 1998. There's a letter from June 6, 1998, which we cite in our brief, and a letter from November 23rd, 1998. And what both of those letters say to her post-conviction counsel at that time, they're letters from her mother to her post-conviction counsel saying, here's the things, I've sent you everything that I had, Deborah's letters, her sister's letters, other writings that we had. And then she summarized those recollections in the very letter, following the letter.
My recollection of the summary is that it sort of undermines the argument that these were just copies of documents that already existed elsewhere, because there was some reference to some original material, even in the summary. So this is a massive, massive problem. I get all the detailed arguments that are being made here, but it's hard for me to understand how this case can go forward and how the district court would have abused its discretion. I've never seen a case like this where there's been this much spoliation of evidence. And so you seem to be nitpicking at little bits and pieces around the corners, but the heart and meat of it is, I don't understand how the district court could go forward with this case.
The heart and meat of it is that the very same statements that the defendants complain about and that the district court found were spoliated existed, and they have them in other letters.
How do they know? How could they possibly know if they have materials that were destroyed in other things? Am I wrong that it appears that Ms. Milke's journal was destroyed?
She may have had a journal at some point in time during her 23 years on death row, but she had no obligation to preserve every scrap of paper while she was sitting in a concrete box in prison. The sanction does not kick in until litigation is reasonably foreseeable. And the district court agreed to that. I mean, the district court's finding was that whatever she had during her decades in prison, her obligation to preserve her letters, which, by the way, she sent out to people. So it doesn't make sense that she would keep copies of her own letters during the time that she was on death row. But even putting that aside, the spoliation sanction itself doesn't even kick in unless there's litigation is reasonably foreseeable. And that did not happen until at the very earliest, the Ninth Circuit granted habeas in 2013. And so that all we are talking about are the two categories of things, the letters from her friend Frankie and copies of court documents that she says that she shredded when she was released from prison in 2013, and the documents that were in her mother's home in Germany.
Well, that's certainly not what the district court found were all the things that were destroyed after a duty to preserve them arose, correct?
That's true, but it is clear the district court's findings were factual. So here's another example, the website. The district court talked about spoliation of electronic evidence, but its factual findings were contradicted by the very documents that it was citing to. So for instance,
when was the website destroyed?
Well, the website was taken down from public view in 2014, and contemporaneous emails from her habeas counsel telling the webmaster to take it down show that they took it down because of concern about the retrial. But that website still exists. You can go on it today. And the
right, but the district, hold on, right? Hold on. You say it exists, but the district court said it exists in the only in a limited fashion. It doesn't have the full contours of it.
But when you look at the hundreds of pages of printouts from the website, there are printouts in the record from the website, not just what's on there.
From the look back, you're talking about from the look back, isn't that how it's available now, is in the look back? I forget.
The way back.
The way back machine.
Thank you.
It's available in two ways. There's the way back machine, but there were also printouts that her habeas counsel swore in a declaration at the time he printed out pages from the website, including a very lengthy detailed story written by Debra, said in Debbie's own words. That was printed out from the website It was preserved. It was produced to the defendants in the very early stages of discovery.
And he, and his declaration said that that was every document that was on that website?
No, it did not say it was every document that on, that was on that website, but Rule 37E requires that there be reasonable attempts made to preserve the evidence, which the habeas counsel, Michael Kimmerer, did say that he did by printing out the material. But also, if you look at the printouts, if you actually look at the evidence in the record, what it shows is that the webmaster posted court filings, police interviews, transcripts. These are all things that are undisputedly in the defendant's possession today. So yes, I understand that it is difficult to show clear error when you are reviewing the district court's factual findings. But if you take a look at the record, it is here.
The help me, what's the clear error here? The clear error is he took reasonable efforts and the district court didn't acknowledge that.
The documents still exist. Yes, he took reasonable efforts.
Well, but here's your problem. You can't show that every document still exists. So you're falling back on he made reasonable efforts to preserve the two when it was taken down in 2014, and in your opinion that was enough. You got the gist of the material, and that's why the district court was clearly erroneous in your view. Is that right? Is that
that's what Rule 37E requires. Okay. Rule 37E is the rule that provides for sanction for spoliation of electronic evidence. And it is very clear about what it requires. It requires a showing that there was prejudice. It requires a showing that there were no reasonable efforts made. And it requires a showing that there was an intent to deprive another party of the—
Counsel, let me read you two findings made by the district court at ER 23. After Milke was released, Milke shredded her prison boxes containing an unknown number and type of documents that constituted intentional destruction of documents. Is the first sentence factually correct, that after Milke was released, she shredded her prison boxes containing an unknown number and type of documents?
To the extent that the question is whether or not there was some index of what was in there, that's true. There is no index, but contemporaneously—
So what we have is what Ms. Milke said was destroyed.
No, what we have is corroboration from Jana Bomber's box book, where she had talked to Ms. Milke about what was in there and what she shredded and what that book reveals, which the district court relies on for other things. What it says in that book is that Debra pulled out letters, essays, and records and gave them to Ms. Bomberstock. Those were produced. Thousands of pages of those documents.
Yeah, the book also said, and I quote, shred everything else at SCR 3816.
Right. And what Debra testified everything else is Frankie's letters and copies of her habeas filings.
That was what she testified to. I agree she testified to that. And also at ER 23, in 2017, Milke shredded documents in the files kept by her mother regarding Milke's criminal and habeas proceedings. Milke kept no record of what she destroyed. That constituted intentional destruction of documents. Are those first two sentences factually correct in the district court's findings?
She kept no record of what she destroyed. That is true. And then I missed the second part.
I'm sorry. The first sentence was she shredded documents in the files kept by her mother regarding Milke's criminal and habeas proceedings. And then the second sentence was she kept no record of what she destroyed.
That's true. But it coheres with the contemporaneous evidence that does not rely just on Debra's testimony, because the letters from her mother, which are in the record at 30 ER 8365 and 24 ER 6474, state, this is her mother writing to her legal team in 1998. I have given away many originals. They must be there somewhere between all of you, especially all of Sandy's letters to me and all the typewritten accounts from Debbie and myself. She states expressly in these letters that she gave everything to her legal team. And the legal team, when it went from post-conviction to habeas, transferred all those boxes to habeas counsel Michael Kimmerer, who then gave NSB Debra's original civil counsel access to them. So it is not just about relying on Debra's say-so, but there's contemporaneous documentation of what was in the record.
Ms. Wang, I want to, if I could interject a question, please. Was her diary in existence at the time she was granted habeas release?
I don't think it was, because when Debra didn't get to go to Germany until 2017, her mother died in 2014. And so after she was released, she did try to go, but she was on electronic monitoring, so she couldn't go to Germany. When she was finally able to go to her mother's home had already been cleaned out by other relatives. And at that time, there was nothing left but the letters that she gathered and gave to her civil counsel.
Okay, thank you.
The factual findings made by the district court in this case do not find any support in the record. It is not a reasonable interpretation of the facts, and it is clearly erroneous when the district court makes inferences.
Counsel, I'm going to suggest you're on really thin ice on the clearly erroneous part. I'd like to hear a little bit more about other sanctions, because I mean, arguably there were some other things the district court could have done. My question is, would any of them have been acceptable? Let's start with the monetary sanction. Your argument is there was no monetary sanction set. And so therefore it wasn't really tried. Is that accurate?
That's right. And what this court's cases require is that the court be certain that no other alternative sanctions are available. And the district court didn't do that. It set forth a procedure in its initial order in July of 2019. It said it was going to allow the defendants to file a petition for attorney's fees. We filed a response. And then there'd be some portion of it that Debra would have to deposit. But it never went through and implemented that and made any real determination.
Well, but I thought I thought what the district court said was, look, the low end here is $150,000. The district court never tipped its hand that it was even willing to go that low, because the high end was $600,000. And Milke had $96,000 at her disposal. So the district court said you couldn't even pay the low end of it. So does a district court have to enter an award that it knows the party can't even comply with? That seems like a setting process over substance.
She didn't give Debra a chance to show what she might be able to pay on a monetary sanction.
Didn't she invite your client to deposit an amount in court with the clerk?
That was what she said in the first order, but she never carried that through because she never made a finding as to what the attorney's fees should be.
But your client, the district court wrote an order which said your client could deposit what your client viewed was an appropriate amount that she could meet, right? I might not have the words right, but she allowed for your client to make a deposit to the clerk of the court, and your client never deposited anything.
That's not correct. What the district court did was say defendants can file a motion for attorney's fees. We can file a response. The district court would then rule on what the proper amount of attorney's fees would be, and then the court would determine what the amount to deposit should be.
Well, I'm reading what the court wrote at ER 25, anticipating that likely Milke would not be able to pay the entire amount of monetary sanctions. The court held Milke was to deposit, quote, an appropriate amount with the clerk of the court, close quote, to, quote, ensure at least partial satisfaction of the sanctions award in the event Milke's claims fail, period, close quote, document 503 at 28. Was the district court misquoting her own order at ER 25?
Yes, she was, because if you look at docket 503, what it says is, after the court determines the fair and reasonable amount of attorney's fees and costs, Milke will be required to deposit an appropriate amount with the clerk of court. It never made that determination. Then it says that amount might be less than the total costs and fees defendants are entitled to recover, but it will ensure at least partial satisfaction. Okay, and then it says, should Milke be unable to deposit that amount, she must identify an appropriate and legally acceptable alternative sanction. So it gave two options, this procedure for monetary sanctions and the depositing of an amount, which it set out a very clear procedure for, which it never attempted to implement, and then alternative sanctions. And we proposed, and the defendants really never respond to this, that the appropriate alternative sanction for spoliation of evidence is an adverse inference instruction, which this court has in numerous cases stated is a harsh and severe sanction that is the usual sanction for spoliation of evidence. The district court never gave any reasonable explanation for why that was an inappropriate sanction. The core of this, of the question that the court has to determine is whether or not there was prejudice to the defendants from any of the documents that were destroyed or that were produced late. And if you look at the documents in the record, what they show is that Debra repeatedly and consistently professed her innocence and that she asked for an attorney. There is no prejudice from any of the documents that they say were produced late. And I see that my time is running out, so I will try to reserve whatever I have remaining for rebuttal.
Well, you've only got 9 seconds for rebuttal, so why don't you just plan on this? I'm going to give you 3 minutes of extra time for your rebuttal argument. Then, is it Ms. Retz or Retz?
Yes, Your Honor.
Am I pronouncing that right, Retz?
Yes, you are. Thank you, Your Honor.
So Ms. Retz will add 3 minutes to your time also.
Thank you. May it please the court, Christina Retz on behalf of the City of Phoenix, but I am presenting arguments for all of the appellees. There is no other sanction other than dismissal that is appropriate to address the egregious discovery misconduct that was calculated to prevent defendants from learning the truth in this case. Ms. Milke misrepresented to this court the facts to secure her habeas relief. And then she's gone farther in this case to seek money damages. Ms. Milke can't pay any of the defendant's fees. What you didn't hear today from her counsel is that between the court's sanctions order and today, that $96,000 has been reduced to $18,500. This court has ample precedent where dismissal plus fees have been awarded in cases with discovery misconduct far less egregious than this. Fees can't remedy the destruction of documents that have occurred in this case. We cannot know what has been destroyed. We know that Ms. Milke testified falsely in order to hide document destruction. In her first deposition, she testified that the only thing that she destroyed in her case at her house was civil case documents. When confronted with sources that defendants uncovered about destruction, Ms. Milke would later, months later, admit in her second deposition that in fact she had destroyed documents with Frankie Al, those letters. Ms. Milke cites to a snapshot in time in 1998 where her mother wrote a letter about providing copies of documents to her counsel. But the writings in this case did not stop in 1998. They continued between 1998 and 2013. And the defendants submitted ample evidence to this court in the form of Milke's own writings, her lawyer's own writings, and letters from Pat Galbraith, the legal liaison of her files, that document that Milke was requesting items that were in these individuals' possession. They had copies, including her mother, and those copies of those documents were provided back to her. She used those documents in 2005 in what she termed journaling, writing a book to talk about all aspects of her case and all aspects of the facts that touched upon every piece of Detective Saldate's interview of her. Her own writings, which she has considered to be the gold standard in arguing that Detective Saldate should have recorded her interrogation, those writings she has destroyed. She has destroyed, but the writings we do have been critical evidence used to impeach her in her deposition. So we know from contemporaneous documents that there were journals. There was an address book. So in terms of Ms. Milke responding to discovery in order to identify all those persons who she wrote letters to, and in fact, as the Ninth Circuit noted in her habeas proceedings, in the interrogation, Milke yapped and yapped and yapped about her case. Well, she did the same thing with everybody that she
encountered. Counsel, with regard to the journals, does the record reflect when the journals were destroyed, either by her or her mother or both?
We do not know when the journals were destroyed. We know that they existed past 1998. She has multiple writings where she talks about writing in journal style, but it's not only journals, it's voice tapes that we don't have. And we know that voice tapes are critical importance because she got tired of writing, and so she would answer.
But we don't know whether any of those were destroyed after 2013 or before.
We don't know because Debra Milke has prevented us from knowing that by her own actions. She knew she had an obligation to preserve, and she did not preserve.
Well, it's not, as to the journals, it's not clear whether she knew she had a duty to preserve. She knew she had a duty to preserve after 2013, but was she ever asked when she destroyed them?
She answered in her deposition, I don't know, I don't know. And in fact, if you look at the sanctions deposition as a whole, for over 1,000 instances, she answered, I don't know, I don't recall.
So she did not affirmatively state in her deposition that the destruction of the journals took place before 2013?
She could not even recall writing journals, and she could only recall writing journals when refreshed by documents that showed that she had written journals, and she had used the words stating that she had written journals.
Counsel, I wanted to ask a question if I could interject. There was the series, there were many letters that she wrote to her friend in prison that described her grievances and also had like sexual comments in them. Now, when were those destroyed? Do we know?
Her letters were not destroyed. We know that she went to court in 1990 before the trial proceedings in her underlying case. And she was informed by the prosecution that those letters were going to be subpoenaed. And in response, she wrote to that inmate, Joe Marino, asked him to lie about her identity and destroy the letters. Based upon her own writings, she gave his letters to her lawyer for him to keep. We don't have his letters. Debra Milke's letters were sent out by that inmate, Joe Marino, to a third party. She kept them. When the retrial was publicized in 2013, she came forward with those letters. So the admissions in those letters, the explicit waivers of privilege, were not known throughout any of the underlying criminal case, including the habeas proceedings. I'd like to address the website. It is not complete. It is also not the only item of electronic discovery that has been spoliated. The Facebook was also spoliated. There is no record of what exists apart from a message from Belinda Reynolds, who is a person who the plaintiffs claim made another allegation against Soldate decades later.
And do we know when the Facebook page was taken down or deleted?
Yes, we do. And we know that. Excuse me.
I assume you could have subpoenaed that information from Facebook.
Generally speaking, Facebook doesn't respond to any of our subpoenas. We sent requests for production, but based upon ER 4738, Frankie Au wrote an email to Lori Vogel on March 20th, 2015, after the civil suit had been filed. Quote, "Hi Lori, do you think it's safe that I make our Facebook page visible again? I post a few media dates that I know of already, just checking back with you for security," end quote. Lori Vogel wrote to Mr. Kimmerer, who is also one of the lawyers who remains through the case, on March 21st, 2015, and wrote, quote, "I don't know, given the civil suit, thoughts, question mark." So what we have in this case is some insidious destruction coupled with lawyers' knowledge, because you can also go back to ER 4417 in discussing the Frankie Au letters that have been destroyed. Before those letters were destroyed in October 21st, 2013, Her lawyers were concerned that she was writing statements and inconsistent statements could be used to impeach her. And on 10/21/2013, her lawyer, Lori Vogel, wrote, quote, "I tell her to be careful even in writing letters to Frankie. They are not privileged and the state can subpoena them if it wants to do so," end quote. Thereafter, Debra Milke had a shredding party in her house. I would note that Debra Milke did not ever produce the Jana Bombersback materials. It was the defendants who subpoenaed those materials after learning about the secret book.
Counsel, do you agree with your friend that in her final order, Judge Silver didn't accurately quote her original order on the depositing of money, that the portions that I've read, Judge Silver said that she had set up a process for depositing money in court, and it doesn't appear that that's in her original order. Does that, if I'm right on that and your friend is right, does that matter?
No, Your Honor, it doesn't, because I think there is a difference between the first sanctions order and what happened in the second sanctions order. In the first sanctions order, the district court did not have before it the evidence of willfulness and the evidence the defendants later would uncover relating to spoliation of documents.
No, that wasn't what I was talking about. In the second order, Judge Silver said she set up a process for depositing monies in court, and it doesn't appear like the first order actually did that. And so if I'm reading that correctly, am I reading that correctly, that she didn't in the first order set up an actual process for depositing money? And if I am reading it correctly, does that matter?
She did not set up a process in the first order, correct. It does not matter that she didn't set up a process, because when we went through the first sanctions process, the defendants submitted their bills, and the court determined, based upon the first order, the court said that it would depend upon Ms. Milke's ability to pay a reasonable amount of sanctions, whether the court would consider whether assessing those attorney's fees would be an adequate sanction. But then things changed between that point in time and the point in time that the defendants filed their second sanctions order. And what had changed at that point is that additional evidence of misconduct had come to light, including finding of documents in Lori Vogel's files that should have been found by the court's October 2018 order, where the court explicitly warned Milke that if she did not get her files in order and produce outstanding discovery, that her case could be dismissed. Documents were found after. In addition, additional spoliation was found in intent for that spoliation, which demonstrated to the district court that there was no sanction other than dismissal that was appropriate to remedy the extreme litigation misconduct that occurred. That Debra Milke was attempting to shift the financial burden of finding all of her misconduct to the defendants. And I would say Ms. Milke, starting out her argument with a contention that there are alleged discovery violations in this case, goes directly to the district court's conclusion that if this case were to continue, that the district court had no belief that discovery that had to be reopened, including dozens of depositions, would proceed in a manner that was designed to ensure that defendants had access to the truth.
Could I interject a question here?
Yes, Your Honor.
Could you please address Ms. Wang's argument that notwithstanding spoliation of evidence, there was a lesser sanction for that being instructing a jury to take they'd be allowed to take an adverse inference. So my specific question is, would taking an adverse inference against her be an adequate sanction in this case?
No, Your Honor, it wouldn't, because the adverse inference is a rebuttable presumption, and defendants have been deprived of the very documents that they would use to rebut that presumption. In addition, in the cases before this court where the court has provided an adverse instruction to be the appropriate remedy, there are other sources of information from which the key facts could be gleaned. There are other witnesses. There are no other witnesses here. There are, you know, if you look at Apple versus Samsung as an example, you have the declarations of hundreds of employees who can provide that alternative information. This is a credibility case. This is about credibility only. So an adverse instruction doesn't help defendants, where Ms. Milke will simply stand up and say, I didn't destroy anything that was relevant. You need to prove that's the case. And the district court specifically addressed that in footnote 21 of its order. In addition, I believe that the district court did give Ms. Milke the opportunity to attempt to right the ship through the sanctions deposition. Ms. Milke was deposed for 3 serial days for, I believe, 14 hours. During that sanctions deposition, Ms. Milke chose not to read the sanctions order over when asked over 3 serial days if she read it. Did you read the sanctions order? Do you know what the court's factual findings are? No. So she did not come prepared to be able to give the defendants the additional facts that they were looking for in that sanctions deposition. She answered, I don't know, I don't recall, I don't remember, a combination of nearly 1,000 times. That full deposition was before the court on the record for it to make its determination about the course of conduct that occurred in this case, as also compared to her prior depositions. Now, Ms. Milke has argued, for example, that defendants had prior inconsistent statements that she gave regarding Miranda. Well, in
which is true. Yes.
Three statements, but they are not the same as the statements that she wrote in her lawyer letters. Those statements have different evidentiary value because we presume in the law that the client is telling the lawyer the truth, and they have an indicia of reliability that are different than her voice tapes. In addition, in her first deposition, when confronted with the inconsistency in those very sources, Ms. Milke came up with an excuse. She said, I got the times confused. It was only in her sanctions deposition when confronted with the lawyer letter where she told her lawyer, I was read Miranda twice, and her invocation was using the phone on the wall to call her dad about a lawyer, that she said, yeah, maybe I was read it twice. I don't know. She then admitted that she was being truthful in her conversations with her lawyer. I would also note that we have documents obtained from Ms. Milke's counsel when she was exchanging correspondence with the Carvel documentary team, where the Carvel documentary team had used one of those prior statements, where Ms. Milke's lawyer said, you can't use that. It could be used by the prosecution to impeach her. That is of its own independent evidentiary value for the defendants, because standing in front of a jury with that admission by her lawyer is very different than the defendants arguing that it's impeachment. It is her own counsel's recognition that that statement is inconsistent, which is in fact very different than what Ms. Milke's same counsel represented to this court to secure her habeas relief. She represented that Ms. Milke had never been inconsistent when she said, no, I need a lawyer. She also said she had never been consistent when she said she was read Miranda twice. Those things have different evidentiary value. In addition, it is not simply those Miranda statements. There are also multiple other admissions in the documents. For example, in ER 9173, these are trial notes that were untimely produced by Debra Milke. While she was sitting during her criminal trial, she was writing notes. In these, she wrote, quote, Saldate hired an attorney. This doesn't sound good. They're trying anything to convict me. I, underline, need Saldate to testify in my defense. This doesn't look too good. This blows my whole defense, end quote. Ms. Milke has contended that Detective Saldate lied. Why in the world would she want him to testify in her defense unless her entire theory of the case was that she was going to try to smear him in an attempt to damage him?
I'm not sure I understand how this argument helps you here. If your argument is that there's already a lot in the record which casts doubt on her credibility, how does that help you with dismissal as the appropriate sanction?
We know that there should be more. We know based upon sources there should be more. That it is not for the plaintiff to decide what has evidentiary value in a case. The precedent tells us that. Ms. Milke can't decide this is piece of evidence is more relevant than this piece. That requires us to speculate as to what a jury is going to determine to be significant in a case. What is critical in this case is that there is no likelihood that if it were remanded, that we would be able to find the truth. The test is whether her actions threatened to interfere with the rightful resolution of this case. It is undisputed that they have. This discovery misconduct has touched upon every single aspect of this case. It is not just spoliation of evidence. It is providing false and misleading testimony in order to keep defendants off the scent of additional documents. You know, when questioned about Jana Bomber's back, Ms. Milke claimed she didn't provide any documents to her and suggested that she only had one interview with her. At the time, defendants had no clue that she had provided 7,000 pages of documents to Ms. Bomber's back. But not only that, we had those attorney-client explicit waivers that were in that book transcript. We know from the documented record that Mr. Kimmer received the transcript of that book. He wrote back saying that the book was great. He knew that there were explicit waivers, and there were failures to admit throughout the course of this case that there were multiple explicit waivers that were made that rendered all of Debra Milke's attorney-client privilege waived based upon explicit waiver, not based upon any implicit waiver, although we would argue that that in fact did apply to the case. Defendants spent hundreds of thousands of dollars trying to obtain documents in this case, fighting for documents. This is not a case where we hid the ball, where we sat back and waited to gather all this evidence and then presented the court with a sanctions order. We were requesting over and over again, search your files. We found this, look for this. And Ms. Milke would respond, for example, with the YouTube videos. She said, I do not have access to the videos. Twice she vowed that she did not have access to those videos. Those very videos were used to draft the civil complaint, were used to draft the factual allegations of the civil complaint. But then those videos would be found after every single deposition concluded and produced. We have multiple witnesses in this case who have died. We cannot replace those witnesses. We have multiple witnesses, especially from the police side, who have been deposed and who are in their 80s, 70s, 80s, and who may not live to see a trial, whose Ms. Milke has the ability to potentially profit from waiting to produce documents that would have been used in their depositions to refresh their recollection. In addition, at the outset of this case, the court limited the defendants in the number of depositions that they could take. We had to develop a discovery plan, and we made all of our strategic decisions in terms of who to depose and when to do that based upon documents that were disclosed in the case. Many of the witnesses are very hostile, and they're very hostile because of the treatment that they received during the depositions in the case. Going back is not likely to remedy that with any other sanction. There's also the purpose of deterrence here, because if this case is remanded, that sends a message that litigation misconduct of this type is tolerated and that the ends justify the means. The district court went through an exercise in extreme patience in allowing Debra Milke's case to continue. She violated every single one of the court's discovery orders for the close of discovery without asking permission to do so. Trial had to be reset multiple times in this case. The prejudice from the delay alone for a case having sat on the docket for 5 years cannot be cured. The documents are irreplaceable. Your Honor, I'd briefly address the website itself, that the printouts that existed are from 1998. We know from the records that Frankie Au was making changes to those website from 1998 and on. We know from the district court's findings that the court correctly found that there were no efforts to preserve, that Mr. Kimmer, Ms. Vogel knew that the website was coming down and did not at that point have everything printed out and everything preserved. It was Milke's responsibility to have all of that material preserved. And it is not simply materials that were available in the public sphere. It is materials including Milke's own admissions, including statements that she gave to her supporters, and a litany of other damages discovery that, setting aside the merits, goes to her damages in this case. I see that I'm out of time. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ms. Retz. Okay, Ms. Wang, we'll return to your rebuttal the extra time that we had given you.
Thank you, Your Honor. Let me first address the website issue, since that's where Ms. Retz ended. Michael Kimmer's sworn declaration is at 19 ER 5064 to 65. In that declaration, he says, "I never counseled anybody to destroy evidence and was never aware of Ms. Milke doing so." He explained the reason why he had the webmaster take down the website during the retrial, because he didn't want the jury to see hearsay statements of Roger Scott, which were never admitted against Ms. Milke in the original trial. And he says that that happened during the time of retrial, which is 2014. And attached to that declaration are the contemporaneous emails that show that it was taken down at that time. He also says that Mr. Au's website included hearsay, his opinions and theories about the case, and other inadmissible information which could be accessed by jurors or potential jurors seeking out information on the internet about this case, even if they were instructed not to. So there is evidence in the record about what was on the website, and the district court simply ignored that. What is key to this—
I'm sorry to interrupt your rebuttal, but doesn't this email from Mr. Hubble say, at a minimum, it should be cleansed of things that should or will never see light in court as evidence that damages Debbie?
But in that same email, he's talking about the Johnson interview. He says, the two paragraphs above that, he says, "This Johnson interview crap will be seen by jurors if there is a retrial, and this will only damage Debbie." What that reference is to, which you can find on the internet today, on the Wayback Machine, is a police interview of Robert Johnson. Robert Johnson was somebody who was a cellmate of Stiers and Scott, talking about their statements to him about their involvement in killing Chris. That was what that was about. That information is in defendant's possession today because it's in a police interview that was produced. And so the district court relied on this, picked out one sentence from this email where there was other information in the very same document that plainly contradicted it. This is not a case like the ones where this court has affirmed dismissal, where a party in the face of court orders has lied or fabricated evidence or refused to obey. After the district court entered its sanctions, its first order in 2019, Debra Milke and her counsel made every effort to attempt to comply with that order. We reviewed over hundreds and hundreds of pages of additional emails, responded to additional and new document requests. Ms. Milke sat for a total of 28 hours of deposition in this case, which in my experience is an unprecedented amount of time for a deponent to sit for a deposition, even in a case like this. The question for this court is whether or not the spoliation sanction or even dismissal of her Fifth Amendment claim, which is what the court was focused on, would have been adequate alternative sanctions. And it is our submission that they were adequate alternative sanctions that the court should have implemented before dismissing the case.
Okay, Ms. Wang, your time is up, but I have one question I'd appreciate hearing your answer on this. This is a case where she's defending, or she's bringing the suit and seeking a large amount of damages, right?
Yes.
I saw some documents saying $150 million. My question is, how could the defendants in this case have a fair chance of making their defenses on both liability and damages without having access to the evidence that had been destroyed?
They have access to thousands of pages of Debra Milke's letters. And what that evidence shows is that there is no reason to believe that she went to her mother's house, that she wrote letters to her mother confessing to the killing of her mother's grandson, and that she somehow confessed that the whole thing was made up. There's no indication of that in any of her letters to her mother. Her letters to her mother and to everybody else profess what she has said since the beginning, that she's innocent and Saldate fabricated her confession. And one thing that has been overlooked is the fact that this case involves a serious Brady violation, which in fact has nothing to do with her statements. That has to do with the long history of Saldate's lies and the city of Phoenix's destruction of his personnel files and his internal affairs files, which would have proven even more misconduct than what the Ninth Circuit found in the habeas opinion in 2013.
Thank you, Ms. Wang. Well, unless Judge Bennett or Judge Nelson wish to pose additional argument or question, pose question rather is what I meant, then we will have to conclude this argument. And I will therefore ask the clerk to mark this case as submitted, and the advocates will hear from us in due course. And we do appreciate the spirited advocacy from both sides of the case.
This court for this session stands adjourned.